You know, a lot of the footage that we're seeing come to light now, this has been happening in over-policed black and brown communities for decades. And I'm always taken back to a quote that says, the violence isn't new, it's the cameras that are new. Now that we all basically have cameras in our pockets, there's a huge potential here to put power back in the hands of communities that are so often discredited or not believed. I know that a lot of folks out there are feeling helpless right now and don't know how you can contribute, and documentation is a way that you can help. So it's important to know that there are small things that you can do to make your footage more effective, to make it more reliable, to make sure that it has a bigger impact. You have the power, you have the right to exercise your First Amendment and film the police in public spaces.
So I'm just going through Twitter right now. I'm searching accounts that I trust to see where people are at.
It also looks like protesters are moving towards the Brooklyn Bridge.
My name is Palika Makam. I'm a media activist living in Brooklyn, New York. I'm also the senior U.S. program coordinator at Witness. We support communities, journalists, lawyers to use video to document abuses and advocate for human rights. It's important to know how to prepare your phone before you actually go out to a protest or film.
So a few of the kind of basic prep things is, you know, making sure I don't have touch or face ID on. I never do. I might actually set it up right now so that my photos and my video back up to the cloud.
So police are not allowed to confiscate your phone or look through your phone without a court order or a warrant, and under no circumstances are they allowed to delete footage from your phone. In the United States, you have a Fifth Amendment right to not give up any passcodes or PIN numbers during a legal proceeding. As the law currently stands, it's unclear whether that applies to face ID or touch ID. That's why I generally tell people that it's safest to have at least a 6-digit code on your phone.
Sanitizer, medication, extra mask.
If you are going out to protest, it's really helpful to prepare to keep yourself safe as well. If you do have any large identifiable scars or tattoos, it can also be helpful to cover that up. So you might want to wear long sleeves or, you know, a turtleneck, even if you, no, fuck that. I'm not telling people to wear a turtleneck. It can also be helpful to have a legal number written on your arm or even memorized, just because if it's in your phone and your phone is lost or stolen or confiscated, you still need that information.
So I'm gonna do Brooklyn Defender Services. I'm using a silver Sharpie. It took like 3 showers to get it off me last time, and the silver like really shows up on my skin.
So when I went to a protest last week, just completely on a whim, I was like, what if I just shoot a quick video on my cell phone sharing some of the documentation tips that I'm already applying right now? It was crazy to see people's reaction. It made me realize that people are thirsty for this information right now. And if that's something that I can do through resources or videos or impromptu trainings, that's a role that I'm gonna play. And that's a way that I can add value to my community. So if you're at a protest and you decide to document police, the first thing to consider is safety, both your safety and the safety of the person that you're filming. Whipping out your cell phone can escalate the situation, so it's really important to think about all these potential risks to you before you even press record and start to film. There's other really important ways that you can stand in solidarity. You can bear witness with your eyes, you can take notes. Basically, no footage is ever worth your safety, so safety is paramount when it comes to filming police interactions. So the second most important thing to be aware of are your rights. In the United States, you have a First Amendment constitutional right to film law enforcement in public spaces. You can't get arrested for filming the police, but you can get arrested for interfering or obstructing justice, which is what we see more often. If police tell you to back up, it's best to just comply with their orders. You can even take your phone and tilt it down and film your feet as you're backing up. We're seeing a lot of instances right now where protesters are being villainized in the media, and so having some sort of documentation that showed that you were complying with orders is really helpful. If police tell you to stop filming, if you feel comfortable doing so, you can assert your right to record. But of course, understand that this could make things more tense in the moment. You know, what your rights are and how they play out in the street are often not aligned. So the next thing to think about is, what should you actually film? You wanna kind of tell a story with your footage. Think about the who, where, what, why, when. You know, ask yourself, if I wasn't here, what would I need to see in order to understand what happened? You wanna film details like badge numbers, or if badge numbers are being hidden by black bands, you wanna get those details. Uniforms, you wanna show what different agencies are working together. Is ICE present? Are police wearing protective masks and gloves to keep people safe from COVID? What weapons do they have? Do they have zip ties? These are all kind of details that can show a full picture of what was happening. It's also helpful to think of your phone as a monitoring device and be rolling on the police and monitoring the situation the entire time so that you can capture some of the context of what happens before a situation escalates. The next thing you want to think about is, how can you make sure that your footage is verifiable? You want to show that you were where you said you were when you said you were there. So some really easy details to film are landmarks, street signs, exteriors of buildings, or the home screen of someone's cell phone so you can see the time and date. It's also helpful to film continuously. You don't want to keep starting and stopping because this can fight against people claiming that your footage was manipulated or edited. So the next thing you want to consider is narration. Do you want to add your voice to the footage? But if you do narrate, it's important to stick to unbiased facts. You want to kind of think like a sports commentator. Just talk about the who, where, what, why, when.
There's a bunch of cops here blocking the bridge entrance, but we can see folks marching over there on the actual bridge.
If violence does occur, it is best to stay quiet because a journalist or lawyer or investigator, they'll need to be able to hear what's happening in that moment. So just staying quiet is also really powerful and letting your footage speak for itself.
So we're gonna just do like a mini filming the police at a protest training. You can film horizontally or vertically. It's just about which way is gonna capture the most valuable content. For example, if I'm filming a burning building that's tall, a skyscraper, I might wanna film vertically. If I'm trying to get the full protest scene, I might wanna film horizontally. Another really good tool is to take your elbows, sit them above your hips. It's kind of like a little mini tripod. Also, if you're filming for evidence, if you're filming something that's like a human rights abuse and you want people to see it later, you want to actually hang on the footage for 10 seconds before you pan to the next thing. I think we're super used to kind of like filming like this to get the whole scene, but it's helpful if a journalist or a lawyer is going to see this later, they want to actually be able to see what's happening in the frame. So stick on a shot for 10 seconds before you pan to the next thing.
So the last step is, you've filmed a video of police violence. What do you do with it now? The first thing you do is pause. Take a deep breath. You may have just witnessed something traumatic. You may have just witnessed something violent. Before you share, there's a few questions that are helpful to ask yourself. The first thing to consider is whether or not you have consent from the person you just filmed. It's helpful just from a community standpoint to check in with that person. Maybe you can check in with their friends or family and offer to give them the footage so that they can decide what to do with it. The next thing to consider is, you know, do you need to blur anyone's faces before you upload this footage? YouTube has a free blurring tool that is super easy to use. You can use it to blur out people's faces, license plates, addresses, just in case you need to keep someone's identity safe. We want to use our cameras to expose police violence and keep our communities safe. You also want to ask yourself, do I want my name associated with this footage? You know, we've seen in the past with high profile police violence incidents that the person filming ended up becoming the target of police violence themselves. You don't have to share footage on your personal social media handles. You can share it with a journalist, you can share it with an advocacy organization and have them share the footage without tying it back to you in case you're worried about retaliation. It's helpful to have a completely unedited version of the footage to share directly with a lawyer. If you make any edits, you need to do so from a copy. You don't want to change anything about the original footage, not even the name of it. So the next thing to consider is timing. Sharing your footage right away, immediately, doesn't always yield the biggest impact. Actually waiting until the police put out an official report and then sharing your video can help highlight any discrepancies or any lies in their report. If you were to release your footage beforehand, it could give the police a chance to change around their story. beyond just the safety reasons, I think that it's super important to pause and think through the ethics of why you're sharing footage. You know, as a general rule of thumb for myself, I personally don't share and reshare footage of high profile police violence on my social media pages. I know that there's other effective ways that I can inform people without forcing them to be re-traumatized by that footage. Even with the George Floyd footage, I actually hadn't watched the footage up until a few days ago. I'd read all the description, I'd read about all the different camera angles, the surveillance footage. But personally, for my personal mental health and to be able to do this work, I decided not to watch it up until recently when I had to analyze the footage for a case study. And it was horrific. It's one of the most devastating things I've ever seen. And I would like to live in a world where we don't have to see that footage to care about black or brown bodies. Video alone can't make change. Video might spark people, but the sustained change, you know, that we're seeing from Minneapolis to New York to all over the country, that happens because of local advocates and local organizers who've been doing this work on the ground for years. And it's important that we face this. It's important that we expose it. And even if video doesn't lead to justice in or out of a courtroom, having video documentation makes it harder for people to deny what's happening to us and deny what's happening to people in this country. And it's really important to us that this information is democratized and shared with communities around the world so that people out there have the power and feel empowered and reinforced to be able to do this filming.
We will not